And his disciples in this room now. John 8:32, he said, you shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free.
That's right.
You shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free. Look at somebody and say, do you know the truth? Let me talk to you for a minute. Let me talk to you for a minute. Over the last few days, I've been in Atlanta, Georgia, talking some with the saints of the fellowship in the southern region, and musing about where God is taking us. Both as a fellowship and as a church and as a people. Tell somebody we're on our way somewhere. Tell them, put your seatbelt on. You know we are, because much of what we have said on this corner over the last 21 years is now in the national discourse.
Yes, it is.
In fact, it's in the international discourse.
Yeah.
That's an incredible thing, isn't it?
Glory.
I learned some things over the last few days, and before it's over, you may have to have a pen and a piece of paper, because you may have to go home and talk to yourself a little bit about this. I learned that we are people who have known oppression. I believe we have testimonies of oppression.
Right.
In fact, I believe that we are still, to some degree, acting out of our oppression.
Say that.
Because somebody told me that oppression does not lead to anything but teaching you how to oppress. What you learn in oppression is how to survive oppression. And that gives you skills. That's why often when people have been through oppression, the very next thing they do on the road to liberty is oppress others.
Right.
Oh, I know what I'm talking about. I can say that as an African American. I can say that as a woman. I can say that as a same gender loving woman. I can say that as a freedom fighter and a justice warrior. That when you have experienced oppression and you are on your way toward liberty, you pass through a period of time when you find yourself really fully skilled to oppress, because it is the normal.
Right.
Anybody understand what I'm saying? Essentially, it's what you see. It's what people in power do. And when you're trying to become powerful and you have been not powerful, you tend to mimic the way, come on, hear me now, of the one who is in power. So, we came out of slavery, the first thing we did was press our hair.
Anybody hear what I'm saying?
Yeah, exactly what you're saying.
My God. God. Yes, I do. Right.
That's what oppressed people do. As soon as many of us moved out of the ghetto, and got those ticky-tacky houses in the developments in the meso-urban and suburban neighborhoods of our city. We clap for God.
Right.
Some of y'all didn't get that, was it, Bonnie?
Yeah.
We declare before God. We clap for God that we would never go back to the ghetto for anything. Except maybe some fried chicken and fried catfish. But outside of
that.
And I looked over the Tea Party crowds. And I looked over the sitting representatives at the Republican National Convention, and I could pick them out.
Yes, indeed.
I said, there's one. Wasn't but a few. Wasn't hard. There's another one. There's another one. And there's another one. And there's two. Everybody hear what I'm saying? And you can tell by the look. You can tell by the clothing. And you can surely tell by the hair. This is somebody who believes that they can change by association.
My Lord.
That's what oppression does to us. It colonizes us from the inside like bacteria. Anybody hear what I'm saying? Oppression teaches us how to live with oppression and then to act out of oppression and oppress others. What oppression does not teach us is how to be free.
Right.